Everyone talks about safety and efficiency when they talk about Rust, but there is actually something that kind of pops into your mind a couple of days later, and that is enums. And in Rust, the enum data type is kind of, I like to feel, think of it as kind of like the secret sauce. It is amazing. And it works particularly well with the pattern matching functionality of Rust, sort of inherited from the ML and Haskell, but particularly the ML language families like OCaml that it originated from. And the reason why it works extremely well to deliver reliable programs is that the compiler checks that you have tested every variant. It has this exhaustiveness checking, and that kind of robustness is extremely important when you want to start when you start like actually trying to debug some very pernicious code. It turns out that, by the way, Rust and the result and option types are implemented in terms of enums. In some sense, they're actually not really part of the language. They are, quote-unquote, just part of the standard library. They are simply enums that are defined with a sort of an OK value or an OK variant and an error variant or a sum or a none variant in the case of option. Enums can be used for a few different purposes. They are very particularly they're quite good for representing domains. And for example, error codes or response codes or transmission codes or something like that, where you have some sort of fixed number of or agreed some sort of protocol and you want to ensure that you comply with the protocol. The states within a finite state machine can each be represented as one of the variants of an enum. That's one way to model a finite state machine, otherwise known as an FSM. And you can actually encode the transitions as methods within it. To ensure that you don't have a problem where illegal states can jump from one to another. Whenever you have some sort of result, some sort of functionality which produces either the right thing or some sort of error case, then an enum is a very, very good option because you can never have both at the same time. More generally, you can actually always count on enums to enable you to represent the possibility of multiple types when you never want two of those types to coexist in the same variable. This is actually known in a particular, there's some type theory here that is worthwhile to introduce to you because you may encounter the lingo as you're going. Some people will describe, in fact, many people, if you're if you spend time with type theorists, describe enums as a sum type. So the question is, like, well, what is a sum type? And let's describe or let's explain what a sum type is. Sum type is by describing a problem. We have two types or two values. Let's say error codes, like I've got, or response codes. I've got HTTP 200, okay, and I've got HTTP 404, not found. My response can only be one of those at the same time, not both. So let's say I've got A and B, and A and B might be 200 and 404, or they might be anything else. And then, so I just kind of get them out of the way. And with an enum, I could represent struct A and struct B in some kind of some sort of joint type, AB, which might be more appropriately described as A or B. And A, the A's here can double up a bit. What an enum will do is refuse to provide the programmer with the ability to make a mistake of putting sort of 404 okay at the same time, because you can't sort of muddle things up in your program. A structure, on the other hand, will always require both A and B to be present if you were to include them in the same type definition. So if you created a struct AB that had fields for A and B, that would require that both of them are present at the whole time. On the left, the enum side is a sum type, which means that the internal types can only ever appear apart, or otherwise known as disjoint. And product types are sort of the opposite. All of their internal variants or internal types can only appear together, otherwise known as cojoint. But that's enough type theory. that is enough type theory. I will move over to the code editor, and let's see if we can get some of the really neat examples that we can start playing with. Let's play with some code. Okay, so first of all, let's talk about HTTP again, and we've got enum, error codes, let's say response codes. And we've talked a little bit about okay, and we want to be able to say that it's 200, and then, well, is that illegal? Okay, and let's say not found. And then we might have to say server error for 500. We're not going to do all of them. Continue. 100. Yeah. Those three are fine. You may be wondering. We'll just carry on. Let's say that we had some sort of server and we wanted to handle a response. So. And we have our response is an instance of response codes, and then we match resp, and actually this, I suppose it could, and we can, I'm just thinking, probably want to derive copy as well. You get this kind of ugliness because we need to duplicate everything here, but we can actually get out of that by saying use response codes and then an asterisk just locally, and now we've got to do. Let's say we're saying okay and not found, actually let's leave to do just as server error as a to do, and we'll see what happens. So let's say A is so our first response will be an okay. So actually that's the content, will be hello from New Zealand, and I'm actually returning some sort of thing, so I'm just going to give it an actual return type, and let's see where we've got to. By the way, I have to provide the full path, or sort of the it's not strictly a path, but I haven't used the enum with inside the context of main, and so I need to clarify the whole thing. So I can print a out, and what happened? Let's have a look at what happens there. Oh, we get a big angry message saying that it can't be printed. That's because I've only implemented debug, not display. So I will add a colon and question mark, and let's try again. Consider using the static lifetime. Oh, okay. For various technical reasons, I need to define handle response. Oh. That is also a problem. I need to actually call the function. Handle response with an okay. So now I have a string, and it should be fine to happily print out. I should get hello from New Zealand. And now there's a lot of messages in here. We can avoid a lot of them with cargo run, just adding the Q flag for quiet. I just need to go into special for special source. I still get the warning about the dead code because I haven't actually used two variants that I've defined. I can go and eliminate that with allow dead code. And now I should get much quieter response. Okay, so that is response codes. Now, you may be thinking this isn't very useful. You know, there's nothing here that I couldn't already do with, say, any other enum. Now I'm going to say that, now I'm going to sort of bring a trick out, which is that you can define a you can define data inside of your enum variants. Now, oops, derive debug for content, and inside content there might be some message, which is a string, let's say. And now here in OK, I need to, so I've got a local content variable, and then I want to what do I want to do? I want to, I'm going to change the return type to string, so I send an own value back, and then I'm going to cast these, well, strings as well, and then I'm going to send the content back to the handle response. Now inside, but in the constructor, essentially, I now need sort of a lightweight constructor where I say that, in fact, I'll just define them in the same way. Actually, that wasn't quite accurate. I'll do it manually and then show you a neater way. So the message will be hello from New Zealand, and now I need an okay which is going to have content of the message. So this will be content message message. Now A will be a, sorry about the wrapping there, how about I, ugh, format the code. So I've got an error. Expected found a string. I see. So it's complaining that this variable message, MSG, is not a string. but my type content requires one. Okay, so this should happily print out exactly the same thing. Hello from New Zealand. Hey! Nice. Okay, so we've actually been able to essentially give our enums extra power that come from the idea that enums are not just integers in Rust. We often think about the enum data type, broadly speaking, irrespective of programming language, as just being sort of an alias for various integers, which are the way that we are encoding them. But in Rust, they are not integers. They are tagged enums, if you've ever used C. So they're actually each variant is a struct that has a tag, which happens to, by the way, be an integer. Okay, super. The other thing to note, you can see here that I've got the size 32, align 8. Ignore the alignment, just saying that it's byte aligned, but the size of the enum relates to the size of the longest or widest variant. So if I were to have sort of an anonymous structure in here, which was for some reason I'm going to encode I'm going to a color red, blue, and green fields. And now if I kill in response time, the size is 30, still quite small. I need something bigger. So I'm going to put in an array. So we'll change data to not field, and then now response time should get larger, and it is. It's now 88 bytes wide. So you can insert extra data, but this has a cost, and that is, even if you use a variant including the server area, which doesn't need 88 bytes, you're always going to use up as much space as the largest variant. One way to eliminate this, or at least mitigate it, is to use a smart pointer. So, for example, in this case, a box. So now response code has shrunk back to 32 bytes, which means that the internal array is actually stored on the heap outside of the response code itself. A better way of doing this, however, is actually just to use a vector of U64, which essentially is exactly the same thing, only it's a little bit neater. And also your consumers will actually have a greater understanding probably of what you're attending. I say consumers, your other programmers in your team. Okay, I've talked a lot about response codes. Let's talk about another use of an enum. I'll just comment all of this out. And I was going to show you what happens if I execute to do. If I do the server error side, the program will just crash. And there was actually another thing that I wanted to do. Let's call it the oof. And we just had an internal server error. And if I run this, you can actually, cannot come missing open. Okay. Now it might, it crashes. Okay, thread main panicked at not yet implemented on the line 20 to 24. So the error code came from this match statement, which is the right place. Quite handy, that works. And one thing I did promise to show you before I move on to my next example was how to clean up the constructor for response codes in the iteratively. Let's say that we've got some content that we think is fine, and then we return self. Now we can't say in the type signature of our constructor, our kind of pseudo constructor, because it's not a constructor in the sense of it being baked into the language. We can't say that we guarantee that this will be the okay variant. It would be perfectly legal for us to send back not found now. This would comply with the type system. We would like to be able to provide some extra sort of guarantee, which is, I say extra guarantee, some extra robustness to say, actually, we guarantee that we will be returning back the okay variant. Oh, and I also need to say that this is a content of message content string. Now, the ugliness down the back here can... a response code from content, and then it's just message. Now, handle response changes as well to response. Now, this should say hello from New Zealand again. There we go, hello from New Zealand. Okay, cool. We have got that done. Now is the time for some other interesting use cases for enum. I spent a lot of time discussing being able to represent multiple types inside the same type, which strikes me as it almost feels a bit odd. But what do I mean by that? Well, one of the ways to create a binary tree, or any tree structure actually, is to create an enum that has all of its contents inside. because you can encode the null, or this might be like nil, or and you know, name this whatever you would like. You can create tree structures, and I'll just move out of the way. Tree structures that are recursive with the use of box. So, and just as a small reminder, box means a smart pointer to some other to some other object, and in this case it's another object of a tree that has already been defined. And so it's actually it is a way for us to make sure that there is a fixed size on the stack, because a box is only the size of a pointer to some data that maybe in essence infinitely long. Eventually everything, or both sides of the binary tree, or all leaves of the binary tree will terminate with empty. That is one way of way of describing the relationship between like values. So you can think of the value here t, or some item of type t, and empty as being like the leaves and the network itself, all of the links or edges, depending on which terminology you like to use, actually is encoded with inside the same data structure. Another example of an enum, which is still, I find, I say super elegant. I don't like just adding super. I don't think it's a very good superlative, but there we go. Is the option type. So Rust option is literally no more than this. We have some option of some type T, and a none variant and a sum variant. And one of the things that's extremely nice about option is that if you have an option to an option string, or an option to a vector, or an option to a box, these are types that have pointers in them. The none variant takes up no space at all. So let's I'll explain why it is, and then explain what I mean. So I said that if you have a string, and then an option of string. Actually, it's a type. It takes up the same amount of data as just having the string in memory, which strikes me as kind of crazy. And the reason why that is that the none variant actually uses one property, or the Rust compiler is smart enough to know that pointers can never be none. Never the zero, all the bit pattern inside a pointer, the null pointer, does not exist. And Rust can actually make use of that to represent none with inside the same space that is already being used by string. In the same way, but different, much different context. ASCII, the character encoding, takes up 7 bits, but UTF-8 uses the 8th bit in a very subtle way to signify the end of a character. And I just think it's very fascinating that computer scientists are able to kind of cunningly use sort of every last bit for something extremely useful. The smart pointer type is let's ignore smart pointers. So option will enable you to represent missing values. In this case, we have nothing. And in some sense, conceptually, this would be similar to having an empty string, or at least that's what it looks like. That's what it sort of feels like initially. But it's almost as if it's providing more information. So imagine again, we had that network case where we're waiting for a message to come, and the message hasn't arrived. Now this would be our none type, and the difference between the empty string and the none would be that, which is would be represented as some string, like something like that, would be that option. That's interesting. It would be the same as if we go back to the messaging case. The none case is the same as if we hadn't received a message yet. But the sum case is as if we had received a message that was empty. So we had some accurate message, but we knew actually that the message itself contained no information. Okay. Muddled my way through that one. Apologies for that. Now I've got a little bit more to talk about. Let's do so. There are one or two more examples of code that I really want to show you before we knock off. I hope that you have really started to think that, enums are kind of more interesting than you might have guessed. But it's always really difficult to like think of Right. The last example that I want to talk about is actually the finite state machine problem that I mentioned earlier. Now, a finite state machine is some sort of abstraction over reality where there are transitions and you want the behavior of your system to change depending on the state of the system. If that makes sense. And a relatively common example for this would be traffic signals. Now, they might be red, they might be green, and normally you would say yellow. But where I'm from, you would say amber. I don't know why. But legally, the color is amber. I suppose we'll go back to yellow just to simplify that. I got caught out in a driving test, like when I got my first driver's license. I got the color wrong. I said it was yellow, and I have never forgotten that it apparently is legally amber here. So imagine if I was, say, implementing a finite state machine transition and I wanted to, in some sense, like had like a next state method, or let's call the step, and I'll probably take a mutable reference to the. Actually, I might take myself by ownership, and I'll return myself as well. Alternatively, depending on where how you wanted to do this, you could actually. No, you can't. Okay, so apologies. How you want to play with references to yourself while you do this is kind of up to experimentation. You may wish to take a mutable reference to self. Rather than taking yourself by ownership. But we'll see. Let's actually experiment. See what the consequences might be. So if I had my traffic signal green, I then transition to and I always hate using lots of text. A green, and I want to change that, then it goes to yellow or amber. From yellow, I transition to red. And from red, I transition to actually, whoa, 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 whoa. No, that's right. I transition to green. Now, if you wanted to be in, I know that in some countries you have this kind of intermediate state where it kind of warns you, I'm finishing a red, I'm just about to turn green. We're not going to worry about that yet. Now, this will return an L, like a, let's go here. I have a step function and I take my self by value and then return some new signal. So let's say call it the light and traffic signal. And let's say we always start green. Now, if I step once and then step again, because I need to reassign this again and again and again. Oh gosh. And I'm just going to implement debug. Very quickly, and now I can print the thing out. Any guesses for which color we are at? We're at red. Woohoo! We started green, we turned yellow, and then we turned to red. Useful, I know. There's a lot of noise here, though. We've got to reassign values again and again. I wonder if we can change it so that we're actually changing ourself in place and then not returning anything. So this actually requires a little bit m of more work. I think we're going to have to say do something like this, where we've got a so self. Is a mutable reference, and now and I also need to borrow it as mutable. So I need to actually dereference the reference that I have and say, actually, I want you to go swap out the actual value that I'm pointing to. So in line nine, the self variable, in fact, the self variable the whole time is a pointer. It's a reference to some traffic signal object in memory. And I have a mutable reference to that object. Now, on the left on line 12, I'm asking Rust to go and find it and then swap it out with the result of this match expression. So you can only step the right way. It's impossible to go from green to red without stepping twice, as long as you comply with the API. So there's more work to do to really shore this up. There are also people who believe that including all of the variants here means that you aren't in with including all of the variants inside one type doesn't provide the type system with the surety that you need. So they might prefer to get even more robustness. You might have individual types for each of your states and then have very, very strict transitions. And that would be a more robust method. However, this isn't a video about finite state machines and Rust. Using an enum and creating a public API to you sort of to sort of give life to that state machine is perfectly viable. There's no requirement to be linear. If we wanted to, we could be a little bit more interesting. But then you kind of need to you start doing things like this, where you have sort of sub enums in there as well. But I'm going to pause there, and if you have any further questions, because I'm sure that the last segment has given you some of those, please feel free to ask questions, and I shall refer to some extra resources for really fleshing out that stuff. That's a poor way to end the talk. I hope that you have enjoyed your time learning about enums. They are genuinely a very special part of Rust that definitely improves the robustness of all of the software that you write. And I am certain, absolutely certain actually, that if you use enums, you are going to absolutely completely miss them in other languages where you don't have anything as powerful. Okay, with that, I'm going to say goodbye and good night. Have a lovely day. All night. Bye-bye.